These 10 gentlemen are in the contention.
And another support Karma is going to be so key to see, as well as if we get to see standard lane matchups. When we're previewing this game, we realize the TSM pretty much beats everyone if they get traditional lane matchups. Yet, if they do the tower trading, they're generally not a spectacular mid-game team. That's actually where Cloud9 thrives. So if we ended up getting the four-man push in the top and the bottom lane, I think that strongly favors Cloud9. But since it's somewhat predictable where teams are going to be going and where they're going to buddy system, if you have a counterplay for it, now is absolutely the time to bring it out. 30 seconds until see if TSM does something to try and stop Cloud9 from pulling this off.
Well, right now, C9 very much spreading out. Actually, you can't even tell where everyone's necessarily going, except that Ball's chilling bottom lane. And actually, Sneaky's by the mid, but at 113, you can move anywhere you want. So right now, the line of scrimmage, TSM, though, very much grouped up.
Yeah, they don't necessarily know where anyone is. It's a very defensive formation from Cloud9. They are respecting the Thresh, although both supports have a lot of level 1 catch potential. Cloud9 might be considering a late invade, but they're also pinging that brush, saying it's either warded or there's champions here.
Wow, that was brave.
That was rather foolish, if we're being completely honest. But it does not hurt them here.
All of TSM in that brush, but all of TSM is going to be in the bottom brush. Cloud9, elimination Sneaky.
Now he should throw a binding in first if he wants
he
to.
He spots
check
it.
He's actually.
Wow.
That he delayed them 5 seconds.
That was incredible because normally if you see no one there, you're like, oh great, we can get a ward down and like invade this buff.
Yes.
And TSM waits for them in that brush.
I really wonder how much of that is how much these teams scrimmed during the regular season and just trying to pick up on level one tendencies. Lemonation didn't have knowledge of what he was doing. That was mainly just guesswork, and it ended up giving them about a 5 second edge in the jungle.
And it's going to be panning out as looks like Ball's taken away. A small camp there with Meteos, and then teleporting back to the top lane. So Ball's shared XP on the red buff.
Hey, but we got conventional lanes.
Yeah, we did.
That's the biggest thing. This is actually what TSM wants, and now we really get to see the level of Cloud9's laners versus the level of TSM's laners, because this is mostly a straight-up matchup. This is the best that TSM could have hoped for from their level 1.
And the odd one going to be grabbing his red buff for this one. Looks like he'll end his jungle route, or the early jungle route, on the top side. We'll see if it actually manipulates the Ball versus Dyrus matchup. Meanwhile, Meteos taking his wolves will be hitting level 3 around the same time and near the same side of the map. That is a matchup to watch. The mid lane as well, LeBlanc versus Karma. Also interesting.
And I think the mid lane is going to be particularly fascinating because Hai and Bjergsen really embody the playstyle of North American mid laners. Hai, more than anyone, even though he doesn't have spectacular farm, goes for more early kills than almost anyone else. He all-ins so many people at level 2, a lot of times just igniting them extremely early. And yesterday we actually saw some level 2 kills in the mid lane. Bjergsen is one of the best people to do that throughout the year. Even if you look at average CS of the mid laners, North America is much lower than European mid laners. They average about 75 in North America. There's a lot of European mid laners that are up in the 80s, but that's because American mid laners aggress much more. They go for way more kills, and farming is not nearly as much of a priority.
All right, now we're going to see how the farming goes in the bottom lane, though, because C9 getting the shove in is kind of the dual lane way of aggression as you push down to the turret and force them to be stuck in the back lines right there. It's a 6 minion lead because of all this work.
I meant CS at 10 minutes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just to make sure that's not confusing.
Oh, to be fair, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the mark we're going to be looking at. So we're 40% of the way there. See what happens.
Yeah.
6 minutes in the future. We can see if they're actually beating their own average records. It'll be something you guys can watch at home. You can call us out if we get it wrong. I'm likely to.
Yeah, these bindings need to be able to line. Lemon Nation using a lot of his mana early, but they're just trying to shove in Corki to his turret. Lucian is very strong at shoving, and they're trying to get rid of the minions as well so they can land the dark bindings.
But here's the first move, though. Meteos slinking into the top lane, and Ball's just less hitting. Hai gonna take some damage, doesn't land. The chain roots in towards Bjergsen. They trade blows fairly evenly, and these guys also trading CS pretty close. Bjergsen slight lead.
You should expect Karma to win that lane matchup. I think that's one of the big reasons Bjergsen likes Karma so much, due to the fact that she has access to empowered abilities at level 1, no true ultimate. Karmad wins most lane matchups, and Meteos, and Bjergsen is very good at exploiting that.
He's doing that so far. Hook not quite gonna land on a Sneaky. Both junglers went towards the top side. Meteos now gonna get warded out, though. More harass coming down. High gonna take still more damage on this one. Bjergsen doing a lot now. 5 minions in the lead. Okay. Bottom lane plus 10, though. Cloud9 down there doing great. Balls and Dyrus holding even, and the little almost skirmish in the top lane between Meteos and Odwin did not pan out. So just the tense game right now. People playing around the minion waves and not finding any true champion fights.
Yeah, so Cloud9 is contenting to these laning phase fights. And honestly, if we think of the overall scaling of these teams, Cloud9 is superior to them. Odwin on Xin Cao and Dyrus on Lee Sin do not scale to the likes of Trundle and Elise. Trundle and Elise, of course, with all that percent health damage and a well-played late-game LeBlanc, can remove one player from the map. So definitely here on Cloud9, if they actually trade the laning phase and don't fall behind to TSM, they should hold the late-game advantage.
Well, right now there's a tiny early-game advantage as well. Cloud9 up just 200 gold from their laning phases. Balls hits level 6 first and pushes Dyrus away. Dyrus actually recalling back right here. Does have the teleport, but Balls will have a bit more money when he resets the lane.
It's interesting here. Teleporting back, of course, that means there's no teleport up for an early dragon fight if that's what Cloud9 wants to do. Meteos getting some deep wards in to stop the approach, but he's just a level 4 Elise. The dragon is not a realistic proposition for Cloud9 as of yet. Still sitting on that slight laning edge is Cloud9.
And Dyrus is doing the standard top lane Lee Sin build after the recall. He is going for Tiamat first, so he's going to be very offensive early on. That's no surprise with this kind of champion, but it means that there's not really a tank line for TSM. It's a lot on Bjergsen and Special to provide durability to anyone who gets into the front there. Balls goes colors as well. Hook actually not going to get spell shielded in time. Yeah.
Desync on the coordination there in the bottom lane, though Wild Turtle had just Valkyried away as X Special out of the hook. So there was no potential follow-up. That lane was getting pretty heavily harassed by Sneaky Lucian.
Here we go, another trade in the top lane. Actually, ulti's available, used by Balls, immediately kicked back by Dyrus. He does not want this fight, but the pillar
nice
comes
guns.
Down, jumps to a minion. Dyrus will stay safe, but loses a good chunk of health for that one.
You can see Dyrus is actually going a fairly defensive skill order on Lee Sin. He's maxing his W. Bigger shield, more lifesteal, and spell vamp to sustain through Trundle. That is generally going to make that into a farm lane, which will benefit Cloud9 in the long run. Balls, of course, is the all-league top laner, as voted on by a panel of experts and the teams themselves. And he's showing why right here.
A good chunk of damage down. Q's going to land. Dyrus does go in. This one takes another shield. And you can see he actually is able to pretty much nullify the damage of Chomp with the safeguard. But it's on Balls to sustain up. He's got a Cutlass and his passive, so Dyrus must auto-attack and lifesteal back to get his health in decent shape for this one. Meteos, though, will kill the ward, but that's going to give enough time for Odwin to grab his red buff.
Yeah, I'd say that's just good play here by both of them, unless Meteos can get something crazy going here. Meteos knew he had a safe invade at that moment because Karma had just went back, yet it was still a good pink ward because TSM was expecting some jungle shenanigans coming out of Meteos. They trade the pink ward for the safety of Odwin.
Now going to be the blue buff going over. A pretty late blue buff, all things considered, but High, starting with a needlessly large rod, is going to grab that, get back to his lane. Bjergsen going for the more standard Athene's build.
And this is actually a good call by High. High actually has very good game understanding as far as the mid lane is concerned. Not many people would immediately know what to build against a Karma. Unlike many mid laners, Karma doesn't have an absurd amount of burst damage early on. She's more likely to wear you down. So High is actually going a no defensive build because he wants to be able to cut through the defenses of Bjergsen if they get a potential gank. As long as he can dodge the harass, the needlessly large rod is going to benefit him as far as kill potential is concerned.
Interesting thing, High seems to have this planned out pretty well. He's actually running magic resist glyphs, knowing that he won't have any in his early build, and that'll help him keep up throughout the game when Sorcery's eventually come through for Bjergsen. Burst comes through, good damage.
Gonna be a lot of damage,
gonna land
though.
As well. High not in the best spot. Yep. Look at the damage, but High says, you know, my cooldowns are better, stays around, and he'll clear the wave.
Not the best of trades there by High. Walking into the face of Bjergsen and just taking a cue.
He does have Flask, and I'm wondering if the second trade goes any better, because that trade didn't cost High any money. And if that is somehow like the game that he can play.
True.
Where he can like run out of potions and win that way. One charge still on high. He's not afraid of getting all in. Exhaust versus Ignite in the mid lane. So Bjergsen continuing that sort of defensive setup there, saying I'll exhaust when someone goes in. Someone like LeBlanc. High still wants to one-shot somebody.
It's an interesting thing that's happening over in the top lane. Dyrus has actually moved to counter-jungling while Balls is freezing. I feel like Balls thought he had a little bit of lane supremacy, but Dyrus snuck past him or something for that nice counter-jungle. He's taking the white away. Interesting top lane matchup. Cloud9 still with the slight edge, but this game is holding really steady. I feel like this is going to be one of these old-school games where the dragon fight has an incredible sway on the outcome.
Nearly some damage elimination. Starting out with a Sight Stone as the usual. The Ottoman actually going to start this one out right now, and there's not a ton of ward coverage. No, that is a Cloud9 ward, so C9 knows about this, but TSM are there first.
You got to be a little careful not to get collapsed on. Lucian is a little bit out of position here, and a great Q by Bjergsen to keep Meteos away.
Yeah, down below, Havoc be the root might land as well. Forced to flash. High also has to. TSM with the dragon puts them back in the gold lead.
Level 9 is actually one of Karma's strongest points in the game because she has maxed her inner flame, that Q, and she can empower it, blowing people up on the approach to that dragon and just making it a bad decision for Cloud9 to contest.
They just don't even get to here. So TSM kind of account for all those minion kills that were coming through in the top lane for Balls and the bottom lane for Sneaky. Bjergsen is winning his matchup. This was our featured matchup. We talked about the fact that High wanted to play for the team. Do what the team needs, make it happen there. 11 minutes in, only 76 minions. Yeah. Bjergsen having 96. So High, you know, not having the best laning phase. That's what Bjergsen's so good at. But now we have to see how it transitions with the rest of the game.
And we talked about this with Bjergsen's Karma game yesterday. It is outside of his style, but it doesn't mean he can't play it well. Typically, Bjergsen will be on the Assassin champions where he will individually go make plays, get kills, end the game at 10-0. Mm-hmm. But with Karma, it's a much more teamfight-oriented, supportive process where he still does damage, but it's over longer periods of time, and it's in big teamfights where they have to work together. It worked for TSM in Game 2 yesterday against CLG, and it's working a little bit here. His Karma play has been very impressive, but here's the row.
Here's High looking for this one. Can they get the damage? Special Watcher to force back. There's the chain. Flash Force for that. It's going to lose a minion wave in the mid lane for High, though, as Bjergsen's pushing down.
Double heal by both of these bottom lanes as well, which means the kill potential from both of them is a little bit diminished. It would require a very powerful dive in order to take someone down with the turret dive. They try to catch Bjergsen. They get him with the buy.
Oh, completely through the wards. The burst comes through. He's got nowhere to go. Exhaust elimination. That's not who he wanted. And High picks up first blood.
Big comeback kill because they can potentially get the blue buff here as well. Four members of Cloud9 are moving towards us. Lemon is low. Odd One goes in.
He gets binded though. High, can he go in for the burst as well? Blue buff losing health. Odd One goes down. Sneaky finds the kill. Wild Turtle went a little too crazy on that one. Meteo should secure this blue buff away. What a good start for Cloud9.
Knowing when to go in and when to go back is some of the marks of the great teams right there. And Cloud9 stayed in despite being low health. A lot of it had to do with Lemonation's pinpoint precision on those dark bindings. He catched one on Bjergsen, got another onto Odd One, and that's the reason they picked up two kills.
And meanwhile, this top lane is just going well for Balls. He's up 26 minions right there. Not getting a ton of turret pressure, but the thing is, he is holding Dyrus down. And we talked about the fact that Trundle would outscale in this overall game sense as well. So this is something going quite nicely in Cloud9's favor. We have to see if TSM can do something to pull themselves back in this game, because C9 are making the better moves right now.
And this is typically in a Cloud9 game when you would see Meteos come up in the top lane and capitalize on Balls' small advantage. However, against TSM, I think Cloud9's playstyle changes a little bit, and Meteos then focuses on trying to catch Bjergsen. That was the result of that rotation down in the bottom lane when they were going for that gank. They caught Bjergsen trying to support, and they got that kill, as opposed to helping out Balls with the secure.
And the Odd One, though, going a little bit aggressive for the blue buff. Meteos finding him one more time. The flash over onto High. Are they going to turn the pressure? Yes, they do. Odd One goes down, making that 3-0. Great pillar forces the flash from Bjergsen. He's going to get out, but the blue buff will go to C9 quite easily.
Control is being lost right here. Yesterday in the games against CLG, Odd One put a huge importance on stealing the blue buff. That has always been his play style throughout his career in League of Legends. Cloud9 punishes him there, knowing that would be his next move. Cloud9 got the blue steal away. That was the first kill onto Odd One. They knew he was going to go and try and get one back, and they catch him once again.
Exceptionally well played. 3-0 on kills. Both blue buffs now have gone Cloud9's way. The red buff has responded to his own side of the map. We'll see if that one gets secured successfully. Dragon up in 2 minutes is going to give these teams time to collect themselves and prepare for the next engagement. Hai added Sort Shoes and a Doran's Ring since his last couple of kills here, so getting Penn to increase the burst. We'll see if he can be even more deadly as these fights continue on. Athene's now done for Bjergsen. See what his presence in team fights will be.
Yeah, as long as he's not getting caught outside of the typical team fights, he will be okay. No flash for Bjergsen is going to hurt as they approach that next dragon. But as far as zone control goes, because of the Corki missiles and the inner flame cues from Karma, they do hold more control around the dragon area, as long as they don't let this game go to the hand.
Well, TSM are only down 1700, looks like the game. Right now, not out of hand for these guys. Certainly the possibility for TSM to set up for a more group-based fight and do okay with this one. Last time when we were around the dragon area, actually, hold on. Nice little bit of harass. The silence helping him win the trade. Ball's going in pretty hard for Dyrus right here. The ulti's not popped for either one. They both save the cooldowns again for the trade, and Dyrus kicks him back.
Still has his ultimate if he needs it. One thing, though, that TSM can hope to exploit is that Dyrus has his teleport, whereas Balls does not. And that will still be true when the dragon respawns.
34 seconds till that happens. Hai has a blue buff, Bjergsen does not. TSM mid lane are going to have to be very careful about his mana consumption. Single Doran's Ring and Athene's going to help that, though, considerably. Hai right now playing passive, not wasting any of his health bars. Might just be considering when that dragon comes up. The harass still attempted by C9. A small minion lead there. Balls does pop the ulti. He's putting some damage on it to Dyrus, but looks like it's not going to be enough to push him away.
Yeah, it actually feels like Balls is going to have to give up a little bit of control of the lane. The fact that Trundle is out of mana and there is a complete Ravenous Hydra on a Dyrus, he should be able to lifesteal up and get Balls out of this lane. So Dyrus taking a little bit of an edge here.
Level 12. Actually, it's a level lead for Dyrus in the matchup. He's pushing in down. 15 minions separate those two top laners. Balls pretty close on pace for 10 a minute. Another burst goes in towards Bjergsen, actually breaks the chain high. Puts the damage back down. Looks like this matchup is going quite nicely, but the blue buffs have timed out.
Those guys are just going toe-to-toe in the mid lane. Hai is displaying so much aggression. It would be exploitable by ganks if Meteos didn't have so much jungle presence onto the odd one. Look at how frequently he's using that aggressively.
Oh, the flash, the ignite, the chain, and the kill from Hai.
Big plays from Hai, taking out the MVP of the North American LCS 1v1. And that will enable Cloud9 to go to this dragon as well.
And there's not even going to be anyone from TSM contesting it. So Team Solomid only hold one objective on the map, and that was dragon number one. But Cloud9 fire back with 4 kills, buff control, and dragon number two right here in the first game of the North American Finals. It's quite nicely played.
Absolutely. Cloud9 has a lot of control here on the map. This is a nice counter move by Odd1, though, to go right into the mid lane since he knew how it'd be going back. And he broke his habit of trying to protect his own blue buff. Gets an objective in the process.
So mid lane turret, first stone for TSM. Lemonation, sneaky. Still gonna force back Wildtur. That finding hits, this could be some major damage. Ulti is popped. Wild Turtle has to flash and Valkyrie away, but that's some summoners down now. Heal as well.
Yeah, didn't expect that binding to land. That's actually why Sneaky was so far back when it did. Still burns a heal and the flash from Wild Turtle, which will be exploitable by the rest of Cloud9 as he's still trying to defend this turret. There's Meteos.
Great Lantern from Xspecial, but there comes the piercing light. Sneaky finds one Cocoon. Not doing quite enough yet to lock down Xspecial, but that is rank 3 Cocoon. It's a 1.5 second stun.
Top turret did go down in the process while Meteos was down here bottom lane, but the push will continue. They're trying to deny a lot of minions. Hai gets caught out, though.
Big damage from Bjergsen. Passive popped once more. Looks like the TSM mid laner winning that matchup finally, at least in that trade. But Cloud9, after taking the bottom turret down, are going to recall. So TSM only down 2,500. It seems that even though C9 have won every single champion fight, the red team is able to find something to do for themselves, get some advantages back. The mid laner winning in CS, the top lane turret going down. The game is still close.
Yeah, the one turret edge for TSM is keeping them at least a little close in the gold. But it is disheartening to be shut out in kills 20 minutes into the game for TSM, who for so much of this regular season was sitting as the best team in North America. But they're up against Cloud9, the team that has never lost in the North American playoffs and is on a 15-game winning streak.
Oh, they're looking right now to make that 16 because they're in good shape for this game. Got to point out the Odd1 already does have his Feral Flare. Transformed already, Xin Zhao, a slightly slower jungler than someone like Nocturne. but has that combine and the transformation pretty early. So, you know, he did try to control the dragon earlier. He was trying to control buffs earlier. He's going for those single target sort of emphases.
This is really interesting, though. If we look at the wards on the map, Cloud9 has very little ward coverage outside of their own jungle. TSM has actually managed to take down three outer turrets, which should translate to a lot of map control. Cloud9 has been losing the pressure game here, which could pay out pretty big for TSM later.
See if they can find it. I mean, Meteos is still taking his own buffs for now, but you're right, the outer ring just now has fallen. I want to see where the ward coverage comes in. Right there, you just saw Sneaky walking by one. Dyrus actually getting a bit of a flank down onto Balls. He doesn't have any vision. The slows could be a lot for this one, but the trade, Ball's really not showing fear. He's going to hold on to that matchup, but I do want to see. TSM are slowly losing gold. What can they find for themselves?
They're going to want to find more pressure, basically. They need to make sure they're shoving their lanes out. Look how little damage the Bjergsen's turret has actually taken, even if he's 0-2 against a 3-0 high. What Cloud9 wants to do is get rid of TSM's ward control so that Deathfire Grasp on Heise LeBlanc can find kills and then they can take objectives. Because unless they're killing someone on TSM thanks to the Great Wave Clear, they're not going to be getting much of this turret pressure back.
Yeah, so the Ottoman's actually going to make sure that he keeps the vision control for himself, though, right? Like, TSM are playing the vision game quite nicely, the sweeper there. Ottoman lost Pink Ward, immediately put a ward back down. New Hyde put one in there, and he's sweeping. So, Cloud9, you're right, their wards are largely only defensive. Sneaky does have a way in towards the bottom lane here. He will pull a small rotation, but Cloud9 are also ready to respond to this one. Trigger ward keeps him safe. There's the Morgana, another ward there as well, and now looks like blue buff, ooh, taken nicely.
And a bunch of damage down onto Wild Turtle as well. That's going to be Cloud9's bottom lane trying to take a bit of an advantage down there. It's going to be tough for TSM to make it back to this turret since Turtle is so low. Here comes the odd one, though. It's tough for a melee champion like Xin Zhao to defend this.
Yeah, Sneaky has so much damage, though. He's got two kills. He's got the Sheen and the Bloodthirster. Takes it down. 22 minutes in, Tier 2 turret bottom lane goes in. And Sneaky Elimination are really one of the shining points right now of Cloud9.
Yeah, they did first pick that Lucian, and they're trying to take best advantage of his turret killing abilities. 230 CS here, less than 23 minutes into the game, farming up a storm. While that turret does give Cloud9 more gold, it doesn't actually do much for their overall map control, because there are still outer turrets in the top and mid lane that are yet to be cleared. Here's their chance at the mid one, though. If they get that, they're winning by a lot. Here it goes.
And here it goes, 36.5 to 32.6. That's going to fall over, making it 37,000 gold. Cloud9, when they show up to something, TSM do not seem able to react. So Cloud9, if they can throw their weight around continuously, they'll keep getting these advantages, it seems.
That's a perfect way of describing it, is just Cloud9 throwing their weight around. It's one of the big things they do when they have leads in games and why they're on such a huge win streak and have consistently been the best team in North America since they joined the LCS. They just know how to capitalize on leads.
And speaking of capitalizing on leads, Trinity Force now done from Sneaky. The extra turrets, the dragon, the kills he has, he is a completed item ahead of Wild Turtle right now. His effect in teamfights will be massive. Cloud9 already took most of the outer ring down, but with dragon up in 20 seconds, their AD carry is stronger. Their mid laners actually, I think, are fairly comparable, but the other point to bring out is Meteos already finished his Locket of Iron Solari. 7,100 gold on him.
Teleport actually comes in behind Sneaky here. And it just gets matched by Balls so that Sneaky is safe.
Yeah, but it puts C9 on the right side.
He actually canceled it. He didn't come all the way in. It was just a matter of Dyrus going out. That means that it could be a 5v4 for this dragon if TSM goes quickly.
You're right, yeah. Ball's on the wrong side of the map. So TSM, they're going to go in with 5. They know there's no Trundle here. Cloud9, will they contest 4v5?
The waves aren't necessarily in a place where Cloud9 can easily push. They should just be pushing mid right now, but they're looking like they want to contest.
There's the no steal on the dragon. 2-1 dragons now. TSM, they get out cleanly. The teleports do pay off, and nothing falls down.
As long as Cloud9 blocks TSM's path to the top lane, however, they should still be able to get a turret out of this. And all things considered, that means three outer turrets are down for Cloud9 as well, which is overall a good trade for them.
So here we go. Balls is still there with the push. The rest of the team is around. But TSM say no. They go down the mid lane right here.
Yeah, it's a bit of a chess match. They knew that their path was blocked, but they also knew they could then block Cloud9's path back to mid since they know there's no teleport on Balls, and this is another 4v5.
But they're going to get flanked a little bit. This could be scary. Will there be a pick in? Cocoon lands onto Dyrus. A bit of poke comes by as well. Forced to run back. Dyrus safeguards away. Mid lane tier 2 goes down for top lane tier 1. Gold lead on that one for TSM. TSM gets away cleanly.
Brilliant tactical play there by TSM. barely outplaying Cloud9 with their map movements, but the chess match is going to continue. Cloud9 now trying to cut TSM off towards the top turret.
Binding won't quite land. Tormented Soil actually pulling away some of the rotations as well. C9 ready to hit both tier 2 turrets here.
And remember, Cloud9 is holding them off 4v5 here, so if TSM could find a clean initiation, they would go for it. They're just getting pushed back.
Well, and the Frost Queen's claim slow them down. Balls the whole time was pushing top. C9 actually the victors on this extended trade going up a turret.
And this means the map as a whole is much more open right now. And because of all the roaming around, the vision will drop fairly soon. There's a lot of wards down right now, but they haven't been placing them actively. If TSM gets trapped in their base here, they're going to lose ward control.
And the whole time, C9 has put some wards on. You see the one Balls is walking by right here. The one he just walked by from TSM, freshly placed. That was a recent acquisition there from the Odd One. So Cloud9 have taken the entire tier 2 ring of turrets over the last like couple of minutes there and got deep ward coverage. C9 suddenly on the map.
Yep. Wards down for TSM. Turrets down for TSM. And they are still yet to get a kill. This Lee Sin pick from Dyrus is quickly reaching late game, and he has yet to make an impact. And straight up fights with Balls, he is no match for that Trundle at this moment. So TSM actually in a bit of a desperation mode right here, trying to take advantage of the strength of Karma at this moment and group up Cloud9 without getting caught by a DFG LeBlanc. It is a very tall task for TSM here.
Well, there's a big TSM wave pushing down on the bottom. Oddman gets caught out. Lantern's on the wrong side of the wall. He goes down. It's a kill for Cloud9, 5v4 on the map.
One Dark Binding, one DFG, and a dead tank on the Odd One's side. He did not have enough magic resistance, and now Cloud9 can power play up the mid lane, again cutting off TSM from the defense.
You're seeing the poke come out from Corki, but it's not going to be nearly enough. The minion wave coming in right about now, but it's enough for TSM to make the rotation. The wave clear for Bjergsen. Missed the first Q, but C9 not wanting to go in. They separate Wild Turtle, though. Lantern on the other side of the wall. He just goes down. He gets exploded by Hive thanks to the flash, and now here comes the dive. 5v3, kick back onto Ball. C9 still go for this one. Turret starting to take damage. Stiggy Pulse Aggro, though, has to back off. TSM will probably hold this push, it looks like, but no, the turret taking more damage. Good dash by Stiggy keeps him safe, but C9 must back out.
They still get a decent chunk of turret damage. If they go back, they'll be able to finish that one off, but it will regen if they don't make it. The lead grows, the kills grow, and Cloud9 comes away with another advantage.
5,500 gold, the lead for these guys. High.
Gotta be careful.
Gotta be. Binding misses. Dyrus, yep, there's the dash. TSM own the wards on Baron, though, to be fair.
They see Ball's bottom lane. They should have a general count on his teleport to think that is up. This is contestable by Cloud9. Ball's a little low on mana, and the rest of Cloud9 is going to come in. This is a bit of a desperation play by TSM. High, making sure his presence is felt just to scare TSM off while the rest of Cloud9 approaches.
That was really well played. Lucian's going to push the mid lane down, and Baron is going to regenerate back up. Ward coverage comes out. TSM do not want the counter Baron to come through, but TSM are healthy if they have to. Poke comes in. Does not aggro Baron.
This is actually going to be another one of these push-pulls. Sneaky runs up the mid lane while Balls tries to distract the rest of TSM. They might just go and try and damage this turret. A minion arrives, meaning the turret can go down.
And three members of TSM are going to go back down to defend the mid lane, but it's going to be too late. Mid lane inhibitor turret falls. Cloud9 up about 8,000 gold. The chase. Oddman forced to ulti away, but he's cut off. Morgana and Lucian on the other side. High misses the chain. He's got to be a bit careful. Passive is popped. Odd One gets the right target. Red buff. No, High levels up. No, maybe even Dangerous Game. Dangerous Game saved him.
So close to falling down there. And it just seems like Cloud9 is a step ahead of what TSM is doing. Every time TSM makes a nice play, Cloud9 makes a great play. And they're continually punishing TSM.
Wow, so solo mid just can't quite find their way in. So they got an 8,000 gold lead, and they get to gigantic wave in the bottom lane, cleaned up here by Sneaky. Everything going so very well for the Cloud9 squad. All these strategic rotations have worked out as like plus one turret, plus one kill, plus two turrets even. TSM have yet to outplay the map against Cloud9.
Yeah. The early game actually went kind of how TSM wanted it to as well. They got standard lanes, something that they generally haven't been defeated when they get those standard lanes, but Cloud9 just kind of manned up and did it. This won't leave too many options for TSM as we move into the rest of the series because kind of their best play was these lanes. I think the picks out of this one aren't as comfortable as TSM would like. They're going to get some of those back in the next game, assuming this game continues to go the way Cloud9 does. and hopefully they can do a little bit better on the blue side, because this game has just been rough for TSM.
Almost a 20% gold lead. Cloud9 making the right choice every step of the way. TSM still try to own some wards. The Dark Binding picks have worked largely well for C9. I gotta say, that pickup, Elimination playing so much of it.
Also, I want to point out the Alacrity Boots onto Morgana. So much of Morg is just moving towards people and scaring them away from Dark Binding and shooting it when they're out of options. He mind games a lot of people if he's faster than them, because he'll get closer and closer, making the Binding easier and easier to land.
So High finds some poke on a Wild Turtle, taking about half his health off with DFGQ. And now the mid inhibitor is open. TSM trying to make the move back there. Dyrus is going to recall. The team will stay and take the inhib down. How good is a disengage? Team split up a little bit, but Cloud9 get away cleanly.
Dyrus trying desperately to make a play in the bottom lane. He willed the Manda response down here. Or at least some action by Cloud9. It doesn't seem like Cloud9 is too phased by this, though. Either they got to go for Baron or they got to go down to the bottom lane.
Well, Dyrus about to take this turret down. That will be the fifth turret for TSM, but Cloud9 has started up. No, they haven't started on Baron, but Ball's coming down. Maybe to stop that. No rush, though. The split push for Dyrus does get a tier 2 turret. Cloud9 not panicked. They let it go down. No teleport was up for Balls.
Oftentimes you see panic out of a team like that, and that's actually what TSM wanted to instill in Cloud9. But they very calmly take a moderate loss to maintain their big edge in this game.
8,500 gold, the number. Every time, it's going up, every time I look at it. High looking for the chain, finds it under Bjergsen, but hooked in nearly on the box. There's the play as well. Special flashes the wall. Bjergsen slowed down by the Morgana active. It's gonna be Medius now finding a bit of an engage.
Oh, Sneaky gets kicked!
Wild Turtle are there. Sneaky on the wrong side of this fight. Kill picked up. Well played there. Special does get away from that one. TSM, they find a 1-0, and they're on the chase.
And it's the disengage and teamfight power of the Karma there that gives them their first kill. A nice step forward for them, showing they can make a play. Dyrus with a big move there to get Sneaky way out of position. Oh dear! Oh,
the engage! These chains, the ignite, not quite enough. Looks like Bjergsen will live. That was rather close. Special also dangerously low.
Yeah, a lot of shield power across the board there. They managed to burn the Mikhails. That's one of the big reasons Bjergsen didn't die there. Very good play by Special to give him the heal, actually. But let's take another look at this play. Sneaky looking to go a little bit forward, but behind them, Dyrus is making a big move, and Sneaky goes way over the wall. Then he actually flashes away, but Dyrus is already on the way to him. Sneaky's slick escape turns into a slick death over the wall. Nice play by TSM.
And a clutch summoner heal bike special kept him alive when we saw High at the end of that clip trying to chase him down.
Yeah.
So TSM back off. They did find a way to get a kill for themselves. They're down back to under 8k, the gold deficit. So we did see them with clutch hooks sneak back into a game against CLG yesterday. That's the kind of story that TSM's gonna want right here. They defended a pink ward, and they found the random pick. Dyrus jumps the wall to get away from High, but mid lane has a dead inhibitor. C9 ride that down the mid lane, and they go towards Baron.
Yeah, and TSM wouldn't have been a top team for so long if they didn't know how to stall games and draw them out. What they're trying to do with Cloud9 here, hoping to find an opportunity, but X-Special gets trapped!
Twin Shadows and a trophy, nowhere for the TSM support to go. Arras not going to matter much to C9 as well. Great play on this one, 9-1. 5-4 on the map, and they're going down the mid lane. Bjergsen tries to find some slows. Balls will look for another trophy, finds Wild Turtle, and out of that one, Ruin King used as well. Corki is slowed, now so is Xin Zhao. The jump in high, looks for the burst, misses the chain, has to jump back. That's passive pop. Cocoon not quite going to land. C9 shoved the mid lane in very far.
Honestly, though, that's not the end of the world for TSM. Nobody died. They did have to burn a flash on the odd one. So if that scenario were to play out again, Cloud9 would then be able to finish. It was really just the return fire onto High that managed to pull them back here. Cloud9 is still going to continue to try and starve Baron vision in this game and get TSM to check the wrong brush at the wrong time. That's how they want to find their edge. If they catch anyone but X Special there, I feel like Cloud9 might even be able to push through for a victory. That is a nice pillar.
Well, Ball's gonna start this one off. He is the tank in the front line, has not yet popped his ulti, but does get forced back a bit. Wild Turtle dropped dangerously low. Dyrus on the run. Odd one though, goes in for the fight anyway. Vol's knocked up. The fight's still continuing. No one has yet died. Odd One stunned up, though. That's a kill picked up by Sneaky.
Bjergsen gets Cocoon.
Still going. Bjergsen, the Cocoon, lands the trophy. Oh, not going to beat up. It's the Lantern that keeps him safe. Dark Binding hits Xspecial. Big Slow comes out, but the burst comes back through. He's going to keep the team safe. And another kill picked up by Cloud9's AD carry. The dive in high. Doesn't quite land the chain, but he does have a team to back him up.
It's still two kills on targets of TSM. They get the inhibitor down. They can just back away. Cloud9 using their gold lead there. You could really see how TSM's team composition is actually quite good at sustaining team fights. Cloud9 caught them out there with a huge kill lead and gold lead, and it still took them some time, but they shoot their advantage. They pushed them back, and now they can start forcing Baron.
So Darius waiting in the wings. The Odd One very far away from this one. No good way to get in quickly. And Baron down to 2/3 health right now. Cloud9 staying in the pit, but TSM want to contest. Dyrus finds a Q. The damage to Sneaky. He's going to stop the Baron attempt. Cocoon's going to miss, but Dyrus will go down. 1-0. Lemonation nearly falls. One hit from dead. Baron won't claim his life, but now Bjergsen is getting chased out. Another Cocoon does land, though. Meteos on a rampage. 4-0-7.
Yeah, the tank Elise coming in. Pretty strong. He's actually going Randwin's next. Void Staff would probably be his last item since he does so much of that percent health damage. But quite honestly, there's not too much percent health that he needs to cut through on TSM. He just needs to be what he is right now. Cloud9 has been so good at controlling this game overall. 13 kills to 1 is a rather large statement, and just playing it safe every time they can.
Looks like just enough lifesteal, though, keeps Wild Turtle alive. I think he goes positive by attacking trades. Using auto-attack trades against High right there, and he does get out.
Yeah.
90 health on him. Gonna have to recall, of course.
And there's still a dead Bjergsen and Dyrus, which is incredibly critical for this Cloud9 team. They're gonna start on this one knowing there's no wards inside, and then look to peel off or jump over the wall if the Odd One looks to steal. As soon as they saw that teleport, they said, all right, that's too big of a risk. That was just a Baron check, more than an attempt.
But it is a 5-minute cooldown now gone from Dyrus on that. So, it's also 500 gold spent on the Homeguard boots that won't pay off too much for him. Though similar thing did come through for C9. They've got three home cards themselves, interestingly enough. Dragon, though, being started up. The team is there. High actually going to be holding a split push on the side of the map. Cloud9 can take it with just four. They've got the ward coverage to not get stabbed as they go. 3 of 5 dragons. Baron hasn't died just yet. C9 have disengaged those fights very well and picked up kills for them largely. They've either gotten a cooldown out or they've picked up champion kills every time they start Baron.
And they're absolutely just looking for catches around the area. You can see from Lemonation, he has a 6.6 second cooldown on his Dark Binding, actually, because he's hit 70 or 40% cooldown reduction with his item build there. Obviously, you have the low cooldown cocoons from Meteos as well, because he has maxed his E2nd, and there's another one of those catches.
Odd One gonna have to try to take the lantern, but he doesn't get one in time. High knocked around, gets Xspecial into the Baron pit. Xspecial is gonna be trying to fight that one. Dyrus will go down and joining the Odd One as a dead member of TSM Special.
Uh-oh.
Now locked up, Baron helping the team. Triple kill for Sneaky. Now Bjergsen getting locked up, gets the root back down. Wild Turtle now getting chased away as well. Goes back in, looks for Sneaky. Sneaky with the outplay! And the team stays alive. Meteos unstoppable. Ball's gonna get locked up though. Bjergsen is alone from TSM. The trophy, that's in the eyes for Cloud9. They want number one. They're gonna be taking game number one. High will get a save from Lemonation. He will not go sour. It will be game one in 38 and a half minutes, but Cloud9 are looking like the best team in North America right now.
18 kills to 1?
Yeah.
In this one, a dominating performance there by Cloud9.